On behalf of the women's cell of Gaur Mohan Chochin Mondol Mahavidyalaya, I wish you all a very good morning. And right at the beginning, let me apologize for the late delay. There was some network error on our part. So it's a late start, but I hope we have a good session today. We are proud to host a talk by a legendary personality in the field of women's studies, Professor Rekha Pandey, who is both an academician and an activist at the same time. The motto of our of the women's cell of our college is gender matters, and thus referring to both the central focus of our cell as well as the fact that gender really matters in all our lives. Now, the World Health Organization defines gender as the socially constructed characteristics of women and men, such as the norms, roles, and relationships that exist between them. Gender expectations vary between cultures and can change over time. It's also important to recognize that identities that do not fit the binary of men and women, that there are these sex categories that do not fit the male and the female sex. Now, gender is also a field that is where theory and praxis are intimately connected. The motivation for us to organize this event today, in fact, stemmed from our everyday lived experiences. Working as we do in a mixed environment, we came across instances where we felt the crying need for gender sensitization and gender awareness. We felt that a dialogue on this subject needed to be started and needed to be carried on. Finally, I would also like to say that while when we think of gender studies, we automatically think of women, but we would do well to remember the words of the former Secretary General of the UNO, Ban Ki-moon, who said that achieving gender equality requires the engagement of both women and men, boys and girls. It is everyone's responsibility. We are all looking forward to hearing the wise words of Professor Pandey. But before that, I would like to request our IQAC coordinator, Ronjini Guho, to make her opening remarks.
Good morning, everybody. A very warm welcome on behalf of our college, Gaur Mohan Chochin Mondol Mahavidyalaya, the internal quality assurance cell of our college, and the women's cell of our college, to our respected resource person, Professor Rekha Pandey. Both the topic and the speaker of this webinar are my personal favorites. Looking back 20 years back, when we joined this college, located in a rural area in 24 Paragana South, we as teachers in our mid-20s were confronted with several hurdles. Absence of a separate washroom, some rules regarding dress codes. We did not have a women's cell then, but what we had were colleagues who understood our hardships and our spirit of determination. Today, after 20 years, we have a college where women empowerment is one of our best practices. We have a majority of girl students, that too a majority from marginal and minority communities. We have a women's NCC cadet, women's NCC unit, and representation of women in all activities of our college, a large number of women faculties, women in responsible administrative positions. We have walked a long path, but we have to walk more. Let this spirit prevail in our college, where women are respected as co-workers and are given equal rights. Let us not demand respect. Let it be natural. NAC teams have praised this environment in our college time and again. Let the spirit never break. Let the women's cell never have to fight over any injustice. In this context, I would like to record my warmest regards and my respect to the president of our governing body, Shri Joydev Haldar, and to our principal, Dr. A.J. Hassan, for being the harbingers of change and for their dogged support. I would also remember many of my colleagues who are no more working with us, both men and women, who had a great contribution towards getting us what we enjoy now, to give us a voice to protest. One in every three women worldwide experience physical or sexual violence in some point of the life. At the same time, women represent half of the world's population and therefore half of its potential. What we need is to use the power of the law to dismantle deep-rooted discrimination and inequality. Gender is not the same as sex. Gender refers to socially defined roles and behavior, both for men and women. both for men and women. Just a sec. And behavior both for men and women. When we expect both men and women to act in a certain way, just because they are male and female, then we follow gender norms. These norms are called gender roles. These roles are not natural to either men and women. They are learned, and most importantly, they are socialized, they are social values. Gender equality means various things, most importantly, equal access to education, equal access to mobility, equal job opportunities and salaries, valuing unpaid care and promote shared domestic responsibilities, ensure full participation in leadership and decision making, universal access to reproductive health and rights, and legislation for gender equality. There are many more. My warmest appreciation for the convener of the Women's Cell, Anupama Mohitro, to all committee members, Moushumi Bandyopadhyay, Piyali Dash, and all my women colleagues for fighting their own little battles every day, which are often unrecorded. To my students, move on. We show you the sky, we reach it. My regards to all my other colleagues for making our workplace better, for our friendships, and for being working as a team. GMSM Mahavidyala is a composite for equal participation, equal and equal access, and equal rights. Thank you, Professor Pandey, one of the strongest voices in the field of gender studies, in agreeing to be with us just at one go. Being a rural college, I think students will have a wonderful opportunity to hear and learn with us. We look forward, ma'am, to your visit to our college sometimes. We would love that. I would like now to request Dr. Moushumi Bandyopadhyay, a member of the Women's Cell and the head of the Department of Geography, to introduce Professor Pandey.
Can't hear your audio, Moushumi.
Moushumi, your audio.
Moushumi, your audio is muted.
Thank you.
Yeah, we can hear you now.
Thank you. It is my honor to introduce such a renowned personality. Professor Rekha Pandey is the director of SEED, Society for Environment, through Society for Empowerment through Environment Development. She is the professor of history and the former head of the Center for Women's Studies at the University of Hyderabad, India. She has been the founding member of two centers for women's studies, one at Maulana Azad National Urdu University and the other at the University of Hyderabad. She was the chair of the Women's World Congress in 2014, organized for the first time in India. She has to her credit 20 books and more than 150 articles in national and international journals, books, book chapters, and proceedings. Her work is in the interdisciplinary area of history and women's studies. In history, she has published in the area of women's history, cultural history in the Deccan, miniature paintings in the Deccan, women and bhakti movement, devdasis and courtesans. In women's studies, she has published in the area of gerontology, socialization and family, girl child labor, women's work, health and violence against women, women's movement and impact of globalization on women. She has been the editor of International Feminist Journal of Politics, IFJP, Routledge, Taylor and Francis Group, UK. She also edited Foreign Policy Analysis, which is published by Blackwell USA. She has received the visiting fellowship, Birkbeck Institute of Humanities, University of London, International Visiting Fellowship in the School of Policy Studies in the University of Bristol, UK, Academic Fellow, University of Buffalo, USA, and International Visiting Scholar at Maison de Recherche, Paris, and Visiting Professorship at the University of Artois, Arras, France. She has been the project director of 41 projects. She has guided 19 PhD and 42 MPhil students in both history and gender studies. She has widely traveled in India and abroad to deliver keynote addresses and lectures and present papers in national and international conferences. She has been recently invited by the National Commission for Women to be its resource person for gender sensitization and gender development programs in India. Her topic of discussion today is gender equality, why it matters. So now, ma'am, the virtual stage is yours.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much, Anupama Maitra, Nandini Guha, and Mausami Bandyopadhyay, for those very kind words. I'm really very happy to be part of this conference organized by the Women's Studies. And as you said, we are located in a rural area, but the kinds of things you are doing are really amazing, the way he was discussing about you know, the kinds of steps you all have taken, where you started and where you have landed today. So I'm really very happy to address you all. And what I thought was, you know, I would really start by talking about gender equality and why it matters. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide my talk into five sections. I'm going to first start by saying, why is gender equality important? And when we talk of equality, we also have to understand various concepts. You know, we have a vague idea about these concepts, but what they mean is something which many of us are not clear. And since I'll be addressing students, I thought I should talk about these concepts. And then third, I'm going to focus on areas where we have inequality. And then I'm going to focus on today. You know, we are all going through this pandemic, and what is the situation of gender equality in the times of the pandemic? And I strongly believe that men also have a very important role to play in the building of gender equality. So I'm going to focus on men's role in gender equality, and then I'm going to give my conclusion. Now, why is it that we talk of gender equality? You know, gender equality, unless we have that, we cannot you know, come and bring about any kind of social change. Unless we are a little gender sensitized, we understand what is gender equality, we will really not be able to understand our, you know, about the society in which we are living. Our whole knowledge of society today is so partial, it is biased, and it projects a view which gives us a social reality which is only derived from a male perspective. And therefore, you know, what we need is, we need to develop a new perspective. Once we understand what is gender equality, it will help us develop a new perspective. And once we have this new perspective, we will really be aware of the nature of unequal relationship between men and women. It would help us understand the causes of gender disparity. It would help us highlight the contribution of women to social process. And it would also facilitate social action. if we understand the roots of inequality that leads to invisibility, marginalization, and exclusion of women, we will move a step further in the creation of a gender just society. And therefore, you know, our ultimate goal is to create a gender just society. And this will happen only when we have gender equality. Now, before we go talk about equality, we have to understand certain concepts. Now, gender equality is a human right. Unless we have equality, you cannot have any kind of social or economic progress. Equality is about ensuring that every individual has an equal opportunity to make most of their lives and talent. It is a belief that no one should have a poor chance in life because of the way they are born, where they come from, what they believe in, or whether they have a disability. So therefore, gender equality recognizes that historically there are certain groups of people who need protection. You know, these could be race, it could be disability, it could be because of sex, it could be because of sexual orientation. And since these groups have always experienced discrimination, it is very important to bring in gender equality. Now, before we go further, we have to understand certain concepts. You know, what is sex and what is gender? Now, sex is something which is biological, it is natural, it is given and it is constant. Men are the other sex and women belong to the other group because of their biological distinctiveness. Sex is something which is non-hierarchical. And, you know, women as such do not have any subgroup. Whereas gender, on the other hand, is a socio-cultural construct. It is something which is created by society. It is learned. Since it is learned, it can be changed also, and it is very hierarchical. The fact that women give birth to children is because of sex, but women rear children, they are responsible for rearing of children, is because of gender. Another very important concept which we have to understand is patriarchy. Patriarchy is the rule of the father. It is a system of social structure and practice where there is male domination and women subordination. It interlocks with a large number of other structures like class and caste. Now, having said that, I would like to say that it is not that we divide the world into two and you have men on one side and women on the other, and all men are oppressive and all women are oppressed. There is nothing like that. You know, it all depends on how sensitive and aware you are of the issue. A man can also be equally gender sensitive, and a woman can also be equally gender insensitive. And yet, you know, we have to understand that, you know, that all men are not dominating and all women are not dominated. But by and large, men control a lot in patriarchy, whether it is property or other economic resources, whether it is labor, reproduction, sexuality, mobility, all this is in the control of men. Now, how do we see manifestations of patriarchy? The manifestations of patriarchy are a son preference. We always have a preference for son in our society. There is a lot of discrimination for girls in food distribution. They have restricted opportunities for education. There is so much of sexual harassment, rape, domestic violence, and women have limited control over reproductive rights and property rights. Now, because of these concepts, we also divide the world into public and private. There is a dichotomy between the two. What do we understand by the public world? It is the external world, the world of labor, military, defense, decision making, protection of livelihood of society, and all this is associated with men. The private world is the internal world of home, family, domesticity, reproduction, children, and all this is associated with women. Now, what happened? Because of these, we also divide human qualities into two. We define these are masculine qualities and these are feminine qualities. What do we understand by feminine qualities? That they are not aggressive, not independent, they are very emotional, they will cry at every drop of a hat. They are very subjective. They can be easily influenced. They are submissive, illogical, home-oriented, and they are by and large not ambitious. On the other hand, masculine qualities are those that, you know, they are very aggressive, very independent. They are not emotional, very object-oriented. They cannot be easily influenced. They are dominant, logical, very worldly, and they never cry. You know, you must have heard at home also many times, you know, when a boy cries, what is said in the family? Kya ladkiyon ki tarah ro raha hai? You know, so we associate certain qualities of feminine and certain qualities with men. And we also, you know, how do we create stereotypes? We have stereotypes of the feminine being very talkative, tactful, gentle, aware of others' feeling. They are very look conscious. They are very neat in habit and they need security. See, all these concepts go into feeding the media, and these are the images which are created, and again stereotypes are created. So masculine qualities we see as not being very talkative, blunt, rough. They are not aware of others' feeling. They are not conscious about their appearance. They are sloppy and they don't need security. Another very important concept which we have to understand is socialization. You know, socialization is the whole process through which a child becomes an individual respecting his or her environment, laws, norms, and customs. Gender socialization is a more focused form of socialization as to how children should be different. You know, how girls and boys are taught to be what it means to be male and female. You bring in pink for girls, blue for boys. We give boys, you know, toys, guns, machine, cars. Girls are given teacups, dolls, etc. If we look, all around us, the anthropologist Gay Rubin introduced the term for the first time called sex gender system. You know, this term refers to the whole institutionalized system which allows resources, property, privileges according to certain culturally defined gender roles. Now, when you look at women, see, women are performing so many multiple roles. They have productive roles. They are working. They are contributing to society. They also have reproductive roles. They have community managing roles. Sometimes they are involved in community politics. So women have these kinds of multiple roles. Now, when we talk of gender equality is a long-term goal which we have. It means the absence of discrimination based on sex, and both men and women are able to share equally in the distribution of power and influence. Another very important term is gender equity. Now, gender equity is the process of being fair to both women and men. It ensures fairness, strategies, and measures that are available to compensate for women's historical and social disadvantage so that prevent men and women from having a operational playing level field. It is through equity that we can lead to equality. See, when we talk of equality, everybody wants shoes. So you give them all irrespective of what they require, 5-number shoes, and you say that's equality. But equity is depending on what each section needs. Those who need 4-number would get 4. Those who need 5 would get 5. Those who need 6 would get 6. So we have to start with gender equity and then slowly move towards gender equality. Another very important concept is gender mainstreaming. Gender mainstreaming means integrating a gender equality perspective at all levels, whether we are talking at the level of policies, programs, and projects. It is a strategy for making women as well as men's concerns and experiences an integral part of any design, implementation, evaluation, whether we are talking in terms of policies or programs, be it in the political sphere, economic sphere, or social sphere. And unless there is a strong and continuous commitment to gender mainstreaming, we cannot promote gender equality at all levels, be it at the level of research, legislation, policy development, or at the ground. We have to really look at the global gender gap in order to understand about gender equality. The global gender gap is an index which was first introduced by the World Economic Forum in 2006. You know, it is a framework for capturing the magnitude of gender-based disparities and tracking their progress over time. What this index does it, it has four benchmarks to evaluate a nation's gender gap. These are economic, education, health, and political criteria. Now, you know, it's not possible to study all the countries in detail. So what the Global Gender Gap Report does, it divides all the countries of the world into eight broad geographical regions. You have East Asia and Pacific, Eastern Europe and Central Asia, Latin America, Caribbean, Middle East, North Africa, Northern America, and we are in Southern Asia. If you look at the global gender gap of 2020, you know, it very clearly states, it states that unless women are actively involved, you cannot have a greater well-being and better functioning of the economic system and the labor market. It says, indeed, the growth of the female employment rate and the reduction of gender gap in the current world context can represent a very strong stimulus in the GDP growth. And what does this report point out? Out of the 153 countries, India ranks 112th in the global gender gap. Our economic gender gap is so deep in India. In fact, right from 2006, when this report started coming every year, bringing out this gender gap, the economic gap is only widened. Significantly, it is becoming more and more wider. Only one quarter of the women in India, when compared to 80%, 82% of the men, are actively involved in the labor market. This is one of the lowest participation rate in the world. We stand 145th in rank. And again, if you look at the estimate earned income, only one-fifth of the male income is earned by the women, and we stand 144th rank. As far as leadership role is concerned, at least we have made a slight progress. We are 136th in rank. So therefore, you know, even the Global Gender Gap Report talks about so much inequality. Now let us look at our own society. What are the areas where you have inequality? You know, I would like to talk about the girl child, violence against women, harassment, look at our polity, economy, society. We look down upon a girl child. You know, a girl child is seen less than human. To be born female comes close to be born less than human. Discrimination begins even before birth. There is a reluctance to seek medical aid for ailing daughters. They are breastfed for a short time. They are easily withdrawn from school. In fact, you know, gender roles are conceived, taught, and enacted in a very complex set of relationships within the family and society at large. The girl child grows with a very low self-esteem. She has this notion of a very temporary membership. You know, there is so much of a bias in our society. We only talk about, you know, having a boy child. And this has resulted in a decrease in our sex ratio. In 1901, when the census data was taken, for every 1,000 boys, we had 972 girls. But by the time you come to 2011, we have 914 girls for every 1,000 boys. You know, the son is called a putra. It comes from the word put. Put is one who can save you from hell, according to the Hindu tradition. So a father can pass on his debts to his son. He cannot do it to his daughter. And the whole rituals, everything are carried on by the son. he can pass on his lineage through the sun. So we have all these notions. If you read many of our texts, the Atharveda says, more than 3,500 years back, when the wife becomes pregnant, both husband and wife go and pray to the sun god, and they say, oh God, grant us a son here and a daughter elsewhere. There are so many vrats which are given for women so that she produces a male child. The Pumsyavansa one vrat is for having a male child. There are so many evil spirits which are spoken of in these texts, which can convert a male fetus into a female child. There is so much of a fear of a female child. And this is something which we can see in our society today. Look at what is happening in Haryana and Punjab. There was such a discrimination, female fetuses were aborted, they were killed. And today, many of these boys who are grown up, they have to get married. There are not enough girls, and they are marrying girls from Jharkhand, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. The women does not understand the language, the culture of that region, but she is only seen as a child producing, boy producing machine. And this kind of a bias, which has taken more than 4,000 years to develop, it is found in our proverbs. Every region has its own proverb. In Telugu, there is a proverb which says, bringing up a daughter is like watering plants in another's garden. If you tell lies, you will have a daughter. It is better to be born in a jungle than to be born as a girl. It is easier to perform an Ashwamedh yaga than to perform the marriage of a daughter. The butter and a girl are best disposed of as early as possible, otherwise they start stinking. So, all these kinds of proverbs which are very relevant today. And, today also there is a blessing say, may you be a mother of 100 sons. Dudo nahao puto falo. See, there is so much of a premium paid on the birth of a boy, child. And our whole mindset is tuned in that, which does not let us have gender equality. We are not even allowing these female fetuses to be born. There were studies done, the more educated people, the more well-to-do people, they are using medical technology to do away with the female fetuses. So this is a major issue, the sex discrimination and the declining ratio of the girls. Another major issue in our society is of gender violence, which does not allow us to talk of equality. The many forms of violence against women and girls can be understood as gender-based violence. Any kind of violence that results in physical, sexual, or psychological harm or a suffering to women, which threatens her, or there is an arbitrary deprivation of liberty, both in public and private life. Today, when we see there is so much of violence, it is so pervasive, it cuts across lines of income, class, religion, and culture. The main reason for this violence is the unequal power relationship. Our whole notion of sexuality, the cultural ideology, the doctrine of privacy leads to a lot of violence. Another very important feature for this violence is, in the Asian cultures, we have defined masculinity at the expense of women. A man's honor rests in women. So whenever there is a caste war, whenever there is a communal clash, it is women who are hit first. Many a times, what happened during partition? Muslim men went and raped Hindu women, their breasts were cut. Hindu men went and raped Muslim women, and all these kind of violence were perpetrated. And why was it done? It was not that they were taking revenge from the women. They were trying to show to the men of the other community that you are not man enough to protect your women. You are effeminate. And so, this is how we look at masculinity. In many societies, many a times violence happens because of inhibition. Women have no property rights. As I explained, the whole socialization process, how we bring up the girl, it teaches us inequality. Both upper caste domination and capitalism leads to more and more violence against women. South Asia is a worse scenario. because this bias can be really summed up by the life expectancy of men and women, which is the worst in South Asia. You know, women always have a genetical biological advantage, which makes them more resistant to infection and malnutrition. In developed countries, women have an average lifespan of 7 years compared to men. Where it help us bring in gender equality. We have to understand that violence is not just hitting your women or beating the women. It has a lot of cost to our society. It has a political cost. We cannot talk of any kind of women's empowerment till gender violence goes on. Women cannot have any control over resources, their bodies, and you cannot have any kind of empowerment till women continue to be beaten. It also prevents human security as a fundamental. It spoke of security at the national level and security of the people in their day-to-day lives. See, whenever we talk of security, we talk of terrorism, cross-border terrorism, national security. But unless you have security at home, unless women continue to be secure in their homes, you cannot really have gender equality. Our whole democratic processes cannot be strengthened if violence against women continues. Violence also has an economic cost because it becomes an obstacle to the elevation of poverty. It impedes the equal distribution of resources and control over them. Food production, processing, nutrition, health, child development, protection of environment, income generation, growth of economy, you know, all these aspects would suffer if women continue to be beaten. And we cannot use their specialized knowledge in many of these areas. See, violence also has a direct cost, both on the legal system, on the health system. You know, when there is wife beating, burn, rape, sexual abuse, there are a lot of medical costs. There is a loss of cost for the production process because the women cannot go for work. The man who's person who's employing them also do not get any wages. If they want to break the marriage, there are legal costs. So violence also has an economic cost. Violence also has a social cost because it undermines the very important function of a family. It threatens family as a viable institution. You know, the family is meant to protect, shelter, and nurture all its members. And yet, if women continue to be beaten, what is the lesson that we are sending? You send a lesson to your children, to your son, that you can just hit a woman and get away with whatever you want. And definitely, it will not lead to the psychological well-being of the family. So it also has a social cost. Another kind of violence which we see all around us is the sexual harassment of women at the workplace. You know, when we were children, when we were young, there was no such term as sexual harassment. We just called it life. First time in 1978, Lynn Fairley introduced this term as sexual shakedown. You know, in her book on sexual shakedown, this term was introduced. It was further reinforced by Catherine MacKinnon in 1979 when she published her book, The Sexual Harassment of the Working Women. And down the line, lot of key legislation and broad feminist theorization about gender relations and politics have helped to popularize and theorize this term. We had a landmark judgment in US called the Michelle Vinson case in 1974, you know, where she filed a case against her immediate boss, Sidney Taylor, who was the vice president of that bank. You know, over the 4 years, Michelle Vinson had got a lot of promotion. She had risen to a very prominent rank. But then in 1978, she was dismissed from her service, saying that she was taking too much leave. She had taken a lot of sick leave. And when she filed a case, the federal district court held that, there was no case because she was in a sexual relationship with her employer. And therefore, she is not liable for any kind of benefits. But when this case went to the Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit, it ruled out that though she was in a relationship with her boss, it was a relationship of power. He had control over her and she was given back all her benefits. In India, we had nothing like a sexual harassment. You have a lot of sections in the Indian Penal Code, section 209, which talks of obscene acts and songs, section 354, which talks of criminal forces to assault or criminal force to a woman with the intent to outrage her modesty, section 509, which talks of indecent gestures or intended to insult the modesty of a woman. We had some judgments in India. You had the Radhabai and Ramchandran case in 1973. Radhabai was the secretary of the social welfare minister. And she had protested against the abuse of girls in the welfare institution. But she was dismissed. And in 1975, the Supreme Court passed a judgment in her favor and she got back her pay with all the benefits. There was another case of S.C. Bhatia, a professor in the Department of Adult and Continuing Education in Delhi University. And finally, when many of the girl students complained, he was dismissed in 1992. The most famous cases of Rupan Deol, Bajaj and K.P.S. Gill in 1988. You know, in a dinner, he slapped her posterior. And many said that, why is she making such a big issue of it? What else did he do? He just slapped her posterior. But she is also an officer of an equal rank and she cannot be treated like this. We had hailed KPS Gill as a great police officer. See what happened in the Me Too movement. So many names came up suddenly. And again, there was a lot of criticism saying that after all, these women are just naming and shaming these men. They are not taking any action. Many of these women had gone to the police to complain. They either did not get justice or they just left it. And again, there was a criticism saying it's a very urban-based movement. It was, why did these women take more than 15, 20 years to complain? So it is not that easy. The moment a sexual harassment takes place, the women will not run and file a complaint. So many of these women who were starting their careers in journalism, in films, it was not possible for them to make complaint. They tried their best to adjust. But then finally, they were coming out with it after 15, 20 years. The whole law of sexual harassment in India came with the Bhavri Devi case. She was gang raped in 1992. She was a social worker working in a government development women's program in Bhateri village in Rajasthan. She tried to prevent a child marriage of an upper caste and she was humiliated, raped and thrown out. Then a large number of women's group filed a public interest litigation, a writ petition was filed. And for the first time on 13th August 1997, the court came up with broad guidelines called Vishakha guidelines. And in 2013, these guidelines became the basis for the sexual harassment of women at the workplace, Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act. Now, how do we understand sexual harassment? Any kind of unwelcome sexual behavior, a physical contact, demand for sexual favors, sexually colored remarks, showing pornography, or any kind of physical, verbal, or non-conduct. We have not taken sexual harassment very seriously. Yes, the Me Too movement was a very urban-based movement, but still, it was just the tip of the iceberg. You can understand the kind of sexual harassment which happens in rural areas, unorganized sector, many of these which never come to the law, which do not have the power to make it a social movement. Our films play a major role in perpetuating myths about sexual harassment. You have a lot of these films where these boys keep harassing a girl, but it shows as if the girl is very prominent, she's very good looking, she's the best girl in that college. And though she keeps saying no, ultimately she will say yes. That's the message the film sends. And it also tries to show that it is male flirting. It is natural to men. You know, even Mulayam Singh in one of the debates, he said, after all, londe to londe rahenge. Boys will be boys. You cannot really control them. The reality is sexual harassment is an assertion of power rather than an expression of sexuality. And many films try to show this myth that, you know, women enjoy sexual harassment, they enjoy eve teasing. But the reality is it is very humiliating and degrading. There are also a lot of discussions saying women ask for it, they wear revealing clothes, women who are single, who are divorced, you know, they are the ones who will be harassed. But the reality is, you know, there is so much of a difference between what is myth and what is reality. We project a myth saying that it is harmless to women and women who object to this have no sense of humor. But the reality is we look upon women only as temptress. It belittles women. Many think it is a personal problem between two individuals. The fact is that it is a pervasive public problem and it requires public solution. Many a times it is said that women use sex go ahead and women misuse claims of sexual harassment. But this is really not true, because what we do, the whole society's perception of a woman is through sex. Look at how the media projects. You have only two kinds of images of women. Either the woman is very happy at home washing clothes, smelling the fragrance of the detergent, mopping, cleaning as a housewife, or she's a sex symbol, selling all kinds of product with which women have nothing to do. So, you know, we reduce the whole women into a sex object. It is also, you know, a great myth that prostitutes, women who work in industries like air hostesses, clients, you know, they cannot be harassed. But the fact is they are regularly harassed. Sexual harassment leads to a lot of job. It could be psychological rape for women. It could also restrict their mobility. What we have done in today's globalized world, we have reduced women to a commodity. The whole beauty industry, which is churning out products at mass scale, you know, we have converted beauty into a cult. Women are only presented as sex objects. We do not look upon women as builders, achievers, and leaders. A woman becomes redundant beyond looking good. Most of my work is on the issue of trafficking of women. You know, today, trafficking of women is one of the worst forms of violence against women. When compared to drugs and arms trade, you know, now trafficking is generating equal amount of money. When you are caught in a drugs or an arms trade, you are put behind bar. But here, it is the women who's put behind bar. You know, there are so many people who live off the earning of this girl or the women who's trafficked. There are 10 people who live off this income. In the village, you have a spotter, you have a recruiter, there is a buyer, there's a seller, she's transported, harborer, financial, brothel keeper, there are pimps, and then there are clients. So this woman or girl who's trafficked becomes powerless, helpless, choiceless. She's intimidated, threatened. She's also raped and abused and exploited before she is trafficked. Again, if you look at the whole politics of our country, you know, today very happily by the 73rd and 74th Amendment, we have given 1 million women reins of power in the village. But what has happened to the Women's Reservation Bill in the Parliament? It has reached a deadlock for so many years. We are willing to give women rights in the Panchayat Raj because it is only an implementing body. It's not a decision-making body. But when it comes to parliament where women can make decisions, we are not allowing it. Look at the women who are in politics today. They are either mother or some important political leader, sister or some political leader, or wife of some political leader. Very few women like Mamata and who can stand on their own right being a woman. In many of these political parties, we have women's wing, you know, where they discuss so-called issues of women related to price rise, violence, etc. But women are not really given representation in the parliament. And this is something, when we are talking of gender equality, unless women have more and more representation in polity, we cannot have gender equality. Again, you know, many of the health issues which women suffer, are because of the attitude of society towards them. This is something which is referred to as 10:90 gap. Women suffer from 90% of the disease and they only 10% of the resources are spent on them. Look at this whole issue of women and work. Women are doing 2/3 of the world's work, and in exchange they receive only 10% of the income. They own only 1% of the world's means of production. We always consider women as secondary workers. You have more women in the unorganized sector than in the organized sector. And today we have more than 400 million workforce in the unorganized sector. And 90% of these women are in the unorganized sector. You know, the status in the number increased from 94% to 96% in 2001. Here, women are invisible. They are not part of any economic status. They are ignored by legislators. Now, having said this, we also need to understand that, today we are going through a pandemic. COVID-19, it is referred to as a shadowy pandemic. And countries like China, United States, UK, France, Australia, you name it, everyone is having a slowdown of the economy. But something which has come about as a result of this pandemic is the increase in domestic violence. You know, we keep saying stay at home, stay safe. But unfortunately, home is really not a safe place for all the women. Because many a time, women are locked with their abusers. You know, the lockdown has provided an opportunity for women to, be in the situation where they face a lot of domestic violence. In fact, before the national lockdown started, the National Commission of Women pointed out to this, it is getting so many reports of the violence against domestic violence increasing. There is a lot of stress which is happening. As it is in this lockdown situation, many people have lost their jobs. There is a lot of frustration. The future looks so uncertain. And as it is, women are contributing so much to the society, and we don't even regard this as work. But it is primarily, women are responsible for all this unpaid work at home. Work has increased. No domestic servants are coming. There is care of elderly is there. You don't even allow the elderly to take care of the children because of the fear of the pandemic. So women's work has increased at one level. There is a loss of income, and there is a more and more domestic violence which is happening in this time of pandemic. We also have to understand that when we are talking of gender equality, we cannot have gender equality unless we involve the men into it. Men have to be part of this. Many men are very gender conscious. Look at our whole freedom struggle in India. Initially women were not educated. All the issues were taken up by men like Raja Ram Mohan Roy, Dayanand Saraswati, Ishwar Chand Vidyasagar, Rana Day. And then slowly women got educated, they came into this whole issue. So it is many a time men are conscious about their roles. They have been, working with women. And unless we involve men into this, we cannot really have equality. And definitely, this would be a new agenda because we would engage women, men also in this. And many men can also play gatekeepers. They play gatekeepers of the current social order, where all the decision making is in their hands. But when men become more and more involved, you will have a different kind of setup. The whole pattern of gender injustice is tied to the social construction of masculinity and male identity. So this is something which will change. And what we need is a human rights approach, a right-based approach. Unless we have a right-based approach, we will not be able to prevent conflicts, deal with issues of poverty, discrimination, exclusion, which affect gender equality to a large extent. Now, we have to really, how do we deal with it? I would like to, you know, conclude by saying we have to shift our approach. We have a mindset which is very coming from so many years, and therefore we have to really change this mindset and look at it, you know, as shift rather than asking who is responsible for this gender equality. Is it men? Is it women? Or is it both men and women? We have to ask what is responsible for this. This will lead us to a discussion on patriarchy, distribution of resources, and our social structures that are there for so many years. We have to understand that, you know, unless we shift the question, you know, instead of who is responsible for gender equality to what is responsible, it would lead us to an understanding of patriarchy, capitalist mode of production, production relations, the division of society into social and economic groups based on caste, class, religion. And only then we will be able to move out of this. What is our way out? We have to re-socialize in a changing context. We have to understand with empathy the gender roles and divisions of sharing. We have to, our whole perceptions, attitude, and behaviors have to change. You know, and once we start change at the individual level, starting from the family, it would move into the society, from society to, you know, community, community to the nation, and we can really change the whole, you know, attitude. So therefore, you know, I would like to end by saying gender equality can only become a reality if we change the values in our society. And we have to begin with the individual. Each individual must make a pledge about his or her immediate action in private as well as in public life if we want to change our values and practices. We must learn to measure our masculinity in terms of equality. We can start by teaching our son to fight against inequality and teach our daughter to break that silence. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, ma'am. Your words were so very inspiring, and really they're actually inspiring us for more action. There is we face these issues every day, like all women, and I think like all men as well. As you said, you know, both are responsible, and it would be a better world for both if there is more equity and equality. Now there are a couple of questions, if you permit. So the first question, which has in fact come up on the board, I'll still read it out. Can we say that from the concept of double marginalization in the colonial era, we have come to multiple marginalization in the post-colonial era in the case of women?
Yes, I mean, what you say is correct. But, you know, this double marginalization, being a historian, I would not just fix it to colonial period. There has always been marginalization. I gave you an example from Atharveda, early societies. You know, even in the when Buddha started, he was very much against the bhikkhunis joining the women, I mean the Sangha, and women were not allowed. After great reluctance, you allowed the women. You know, in the bhakti movement, you had all these Kabir, Tulsidas and others, you know, they were talking of a change in society. They were against the Brahmin, against the temple, and they wanted a change for themselves. But when it came to women, again, you look upon women as only being Sati Savitri, devoted to the family. And in contrast, you had women who were so bold. Akka Mahadevi, who walked out naked. You know, she says in one of her writings, translated by A.K. Ramanujam, take these husbands who decay and die and throw them into your kitchen fires. No God, this man. Imagine in 12th century. Lalded in Kashmir in 14th century, she also walks out naked. You had Bahina Bai in Maharashtra. You know, I can go on and on. So instead of saying only for the colonial period, I would take it much further. But yes, there is an increase in marginalization. See, the sexuality of women is always feared. But what is important today is there is multiple marginalization. One, definitely because of gender. And there is marginalization also because of your class, your caste, your urban-rural background. And now because of the pandemic, I also see a major divide because of the digital divide. You know, people who have access to internet and all, they are attending classes. Many private colleges are going. What is happening to government schools and other places? You know, we have just closed them because the infrastructure is not available. So yes, today there is a multiple marginalization. I agree with you. But yes, we need to take this marginalization much further than only colonial period.
And the next question is from Shuparna Ganguly. If I become a victim of cyber bullying by one of my colleagues, then what should I do? And yeah. What is to be
See,
done?
See, again, when I talk of violence, unfortunately, I went again more than 1 hour. I was not sure how much I should speak. Cyber bullying is a major issue. I myself am part of the sexual harassment committee in my university. And it has increased today because, you know, you are sitting behind a computer. It gives you an anonymity and you think, you know, that you can really bully. And we have dealt with lot of cases. Yes, today it is a fact. But again, we have very strong laws against it. You can always make a complaint. See, the police has the infrastructure to find out. I'm sure you have read so many cases in the newspapers, etc., when there were complaints, when, you know, obscene pictures were put up and all that, you know, the police did find out. So the best is, you know, the institution is also to be aware of it. You can first, you know, make a complaint, make them aware what is happening, and a police complaint has to be filed. And only then you can deal with it. You know, this is another form of violence which is becoming very prominent, and we have to deal with it.
Thank you, ma'am. There are actually a number of questions coming up. Huh. Do you think that women will emerge more powerful in the post-pandemic world, or will the backbone of rural women be further weakened?
See, I don't believe in this more powerful and less powerful. When we are questioning the whole power structure as women, as gender studies experts, you know, we believe in an equal society where there is sharing. Why is it that, you know, somebody said women's studies is that men do not eat? Do you think that men do not eat? Why is it that, you know, work at home and taking care is only regarded as women's work and not men's work? Why is it that, you know, women are taught stitching and all? When boys are studying in hostels, they also need to learn stitching when their pant tears or when their button breaks. So we divided all these roles. So I think, you know, rather than talking about power to whom, let us talk about an equal society where there is empathy, where there is sharing, where there is distribution. I would feel that. Yes, you know, the pandemic, as I mentioned, I could not go into detail because of lack of time. It has definitely weakened. And I don't think women will emerge stronger because, as I said, you know, it is called the double pandemic. There is so much of violence which is happening. More and more care work is increasing for women. Domestic work has increased. And look at, you know, we only saw the migration. Look, a pandemic definitely affects women much more than it affects men. So I don't think, you know, who will emerge stronger or something. I seriously believe in this equal world where we need to share and, you know, do away with these kinds of definitions of power structures.
The next question is, what should be the role of ACT rules and awareness programs to prohibit such types of crimes and crisis?
See, definitely you have a women's studies center in your university. They should put up these rules. See, many times women are not even aware of what are the rules. And unless you are aware, how can you go? And you know, when any kind of harassment takes place, it's not immediately that you go and make a complaint. But you know, you have to keep a diary for your own safety. Tomorrow they will ask you to show, you know, what evidence do you show? You need to talk to people, your other friends. Tell them, you know, you can even talk to the person who is harassing you saying that, look, this is not allowed and I don't understand why you're doing this. So, you know, try to create an evidence so that when, you know, there is a formal complaint, you have enough evidence to deal with it. So we have to, you know, rules have to be people, women and others have to be made aware of what are the roles that are existing to deal with these issues.
There are two more questions that I can see them now. One is, which is the bigger crisis, bigger issue for women leaders, the glass ceiling or the glass cliff?
I think both glass cliff or glass ceiling, you know, both are obstructing women. See, it's not so easy. You know, we are talking of a civilization more than 4,000 years back, the kind of mindset we have. And you do not have faith whether women can really, you know, perform their fully potential. So the whole, you know, discussion, you don't want them to give them leadership role because anyone who has power would not like to give it, you know. So I think it is, you know, both these issues would be important at in different contexts, in different places where it exists.
The last question that we have is from Meenakshi Paul. She asks, is economic empowerment the only solution to gender equality? Why can't we recognize the role of the homemakers beyond the economic matrix?
See, I don't believe in economic empowerment as being the only criteria. To me, it is the mindset which has to change. I give a lot of importance to the mindset, you know, because today we know what is politically right. And we may have any kind of beliefs, but in a public forum, we can all speak what is politically right. So unless we change the mindset and really sincerely believe that inequality, nothing is going to happen. I'll give you an example. You know, the Himachal Pradesh government came up with a very wonderful idea. It said that all housewife will be given one day casual leave a month. Imagine you are getting up one day and say, I am on casual leave. Do you think it will happen? I'm not going to cook. I'm not going to do anything. See, again, women are also in these roles. It's very difficult. While I recognize that, yes, there should be economic empowerment, but more than economic empowerment, who is having control over those resources? How many women have control over what they are earning? How can they spend that money? So, yes, while we have to recognize women's contribution to the household. There have been lot of studies which try to show that, you know, if you calculate the kind of work which women are doing at home, and if you calculate it in monetary terms, many of the men will not be able to afford the services rendered by the women. And there have been lot of studies abroad. But unless, you know, there is a change in mindset and we recognize that this is also work. See, how do we define work? Economists have told us work is something for which you get paid. So if I go and teach in a college, I go and teach in a school, I get some salary out of it, that is work. But if I'm teaching at home to my own children, after all, that's my duty. If I go and teach, I mean, if I go and cook in someone else's house and I get money for that, that becomes work. But if I'm cooking in my own house, after all, that's my own, you know, duty. And only, you know, because economists have defined that this is work. And if you remember earlier census, prior to the 2000 census, you know, you would go to every home and you would ask a woman, what do? And women also internalized it, oh, I do nothing. And they would take in nothing, 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 nothing. And if you look at the gross national product of our country, we have so many women and more than 80% of them are sitting and doing nothing. So then, you know, there was a lot of demand from the women's movement and they changed the question. If you look at the questions asked in the census, they do not ask, what do you do? They say, how do you spend your time? Then she says, okay, I do cooking for so many hours, I do cleaning for so many hours, I manage for so many hours. And then we calculate the contribution of the women. So, you know, we have to learn to ask new questions so that we can really give importance to what women are contributing. That is something which is very important.
In fact, I think there are male economists who defined work only about something that people get paid for. Anyway, but ma'am, the one final question is, I think it's there on the screen. would you kindly suggest some books where we can get such discussions? As you said, Buddha gave freedom, gave women freedom after much reluctance.
I have written a lot on these issues. If you go to the Academic Edu page, you can freely download those articles. There are a lot of articles on some of the points which I was saying. But then I would really suggest Gerda Lerner's Creation of Patriarchy as a very important book. She really talks about how patriarchy developed. It's a historical work. And I'm sure, there is a long list of books. If you have my email, I can always, because every topic could have a different list of books which one can see. So I can always write to you and send you a list of books which would be important.
Ma'am, we cannot thank you enough for the time that you've given us today. And it has really inspired us to in all our future activities. But before we, there will be a formal vote of thanks. But before we go into the formal valedictory session, there is a short video, just under 2 minutes, that a faculty member of the music department, she has created this video. So we wanted to share it with all our viewers today.
Okay.
So with your permission, ma'am.
Okay.
शक्ति जगो सूर्य जगो उद्यमी जग
Anjali, can we move on to the valedictory? There's a problem with the video.
Oh, it's not coming?
No, it doesn't seem to be coming.
Okay, so I'm
sure. All right, I will now request.
You can maybe share it with me later on. I'd love to see it. Okay?
Surely, surely we'll do that, ma'am. And I'd now like to request Professor Dr. Moushumi Bandyopadhyay, head of the Geography Department, to offer the formal vote of thanks.
Thank you, Anupama. First and foremost, I would like to give thanks to today's speaker, Professor Rekha Pandey, for her excellent deliberations. Whenever our environment, that means inside or outside home, bears inequality to every aspect of life, her speech reminisces courage and inspiration to all participants, irrespective of gender or class. Again, I would like to take the opportunity to extend our heartfelt gratitude to ma'am. We are also thankful to our GB President, Sri Joydev Haldar, our Principal Sir, Dr. A.J. Hassan, and GB members for their extended support and inspiration. Words are insufficient for thanking our IQAC coordinator, Professor Ranjini Guha, Bursar Dr. Tapas Kumar Pal, and academic in charge, Professor Anupama Moitru, for their overall work cooperation. Special thanks to Anantadev Chando and Professor Somarus Pramanik, head Computer Science Department, for their technical support. Thanks to all our colleagues for being with us. But last, but not the least, a very big thanks to all our viewers and participants who made this event a grand success. With that, we come to the end of our today's session. Thank you all.
Thank you very much. Okay, all the best.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.